Good morning. I call the meeting of the Lord Selkirk West Caledonian Community Committee to order. It's January 10th, 2022. I'd like to acknowledge that we're on Treaty 1 and Dakota Nation's territory in the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation.
Mr. Clerk, I'd like to call a motion that Councillor Jeffrey Sharma act as chair for today's meeting.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Mr. Clerk, I'd like to first of all introduce you, Councillor Santos, who is participating remote, representing the Point Douglas ward. We have Mr. Rack Hare, planner, with us remote. Mr. Daniel Trenchard, he's also a remote member of the administration, and our clerk, Mr. Peter Prinsloo. Do we have minutes from the last meeting, Mr. Clerk?
Yes, we do, from the November 29th meeting.
Councillor Santos, if you would move those.
So moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Contrary? That's carried. Inspector Lutz, unfortunately, isn't able to join us today. He has other duties that he needs to attend to. Our next delegation, Mr. Clerk?
Our next delegation is Aaron Snyder and Michael Kubasiewicz from Ironclad Developments with respect to Report 3 on our agenda, and that is plan approval at Cartesian Gate, file DASZ37/2014. Good morning, gentlemen. You're now live with the committee. You have up to 10 minutes to make your presentation. And I do note that the delegation has submitted a submission after the deadline. So if we can just have a suspension of the rules to allow the submission, and then they can share that as well.
Councillor Santos?
So moved. I move suspension of the rules.
Okay, Councillor Santos moves suspension to allow the submission. All in favor? Contrary? Aye. That's carried. Welcome, Michael and Aaron. Thank you for being with us here to present on the plan approval Cartesian Gate project. We have 10 minutes on the clock for you.
Good morning.
And you're on mute, I believe. We can't hear you.
Oh, sorry. Are you able to hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, I'm just going to confirm that Michael can also hear. I think he may be having a technical issue. One moment, please.
Michael, can you hear us in the chamber? And he's not nodding or anything, so I don't think he can hear.
Michael, you now have an audio device connected. If you just want to unmute that and confirm that you can hear us and that you can speak to us.
Yes, thank you. All good.
Okay, wonderful. You may proceed with your presentation.
Thank you. Good morning, Mr. Chairperson, Councillors.
Aaron, can you hear us now? I think Aaron's having trouble now.
I can hear, yeah.
Okay, excellent. Go ahead.
Okay, technical challenges resolved. Good morning, Madam Chairperson, Councillors, and thank you for the opportunity to speak to this plan approval today. My name is Mike Kubasiewicz. I'm the development manager with Ironclad Developments, the applicant for this plan approval. Joining me today is Aaron Snyder, the urban planner on our team for this project. We have a presentation that should take no more than 10 minutes, and Aaron and I will be pleased to answer any questions you may have. Next slide, please. To set the stage, I'd just like to share some brief comments about the Ironclad Group and our approach to designing, building, and operating multifamily rental housing projects. Ironclad is a Winnipeg-based company founded in 2014, dedicated to creating high-quality, purpose-built rental projects with industry-leading amenities for our residents. In the 8 years since Ironclad was established, we have completed 17 developments in multiple jurisdictions across Canada, from Vancouver Island to the Ottawa Valley, and we have another 19 projects currently underway. That includes 8 projects completed and another 11 underway in the Winnipeg market. We have a highly integrated business model with our own construction crews and with professional planners, architects, engineers, and project managers in-house. We also have a management company, Ironclad Properties, that leases and manages our completed projects. We draw on that experience to better understand the types of units and amenities that will enable our projects to attract and retain tenants in an increasingly competitive market over the long haul. Part of our business philosophy in every jurisdiction is to work collaboratively with municipal staff and elected representatives, and we very much appreciated the extensive dialogue we had with the city's planner, Mr. Hare, throughout the design process for Amber Corners, as well as the opportunity to meet with Councillor Sharma to review the project in advance of today's meeting. Another hallmark of the Ironclad approach is that we tailored the design of each project to the characteristics of the site and the surrounding neighborhood. Being both a developer and a landlord with a continuing presence on the site, we strive to create projects that will be positive additions to the community. We believe Amber Corners will achieve that goal, creating a visual landmark at this prominent corner and providing an attractive, functional, and durable addition to the range of housing options available for the residents of this growing community. And with that brief introduction, I'll turn it over to Aaron to walk you through the specifics of the project.
Thank you, Michael, and good morning, councillors. So we have a brief presentation on the Amber Corners development now, about 5 to 6 minutes. We are seeking plan approval for the proposed development of Amber Corners. There are no variances or conditional uses associated with this application, and the planner's report is supportive. I will very briefly provide some context for the project from a planning and development perspective, and then I'll give a quick overview of the project itself, as well as some of the site plan details, landscape plan, and resident amenities. So the proposed development is located at the northeast corner of the intersection of Pipeline Road and Templeton Avenue. The site and the surrounding area are designated as new communities by our Winnipeg. These areas are planned to allow for a mix of uses, including higher density residential uses. Property also falls within the Precinct E or Court Avenue Precinct Secondary Plan, which was approved by Council in 2014. This site is located at the west end of sub-area A of this plan and corresponds generally to the Amber Gates Master Development Area. Property is one of two multifamily parcels bookending the Amber Gates development, with detached single-family and attached two-family homes making up the rest of the development. The Precinct E secondary plan designates this property as a higher density residential policy area. And finally, the property was subdivided and rezoned to RMFL in 2016 at the same time as the surrounding properties were rezoned and subdivided. In summary, this area was comprehensively planned both from a land use and infrastructure perspective to incorporate multifamily residential development at this location. So now looking at the proposed development itself, Amber Corners will include three buildings and a total of 304 units in a mixture of bachelor, 1, 2, and 3 bedroom configurations. Building one is located at the south of the property and is roughly L-shaped, facing Templeton and the intersection with Pipeline Road. Building two is located at the northwest of the property, facing Pipeline Road. And building three is also L-shaped and located to the interior of the property towards the northeast. The zoning bylaw requires 456 parking spaces for the number of units proposed, and we are proposing a total of 457 parking spaces across our surface parking lot and underground parkade. And here's the parkade level plan. We are also proposing 95 secure bike parking spaces in our underground parkade, including 50 spaces in a locked enclosure with a nearby bicycle repair area. And those areas are indicated here, if you're able to see my cursor, directly underneath our main entrance, underneath building one. We are proposing a generous landscape plan that exceeds the numbers of both shrubs and trees required by the zoning bylaw. We have also proposed a buffer between our development and surrounding residential properties to the north and east, consisting of both a 6-foot privacy fence and strategically placed trees to enhance privacy. The Dog Run, located here towards the northwest of the property, is approximately 1,800 square feet in size and surrounded by a 4-foot chain link fence. The base of the Dog Run is pea gravel to be comfortable for dog feet while still easy to clean and more durable than grass. And we are also proposing benches at all building entrances, as well as bike racks for convenient visitor bicycle parking. This aerial perspective rendering shows the proposed development from the south across Templeton Avenue and gives a sense of the development's relationship to the street, as well as the parking that is oriented towards the interior of the property away from public view. We are proposing an array of amenities for residents of this development. As indicated by the Dog Run I mentioned earlier, this will be a pet-friendly development, which is true of all Ironclad projects. And we are also providing a pet wash station on the ground floor of Building 1. You're proposing a large fitness center, shown here at the bottom right, on the third floor, a resident lounge located here at the top right on the second floor, as well as a rooftop patio, shown here at the bottom left, all of which will be facing the corner of Templeton and Pipeline. These amenities will add eyes on the street, as well as create an active and welcoming front entrance to the development. Other amenities included will be a theater room, a games area, a hot tub, and a sauna. So thank you for your time this morning to present about our plan approval application for Amber Corners, and we'd be happy to answer any questions you may have at this time. Thank you very much.
Thank you for that presentation. Aaron, could you zero in on the front of the building here on Pipeline? It's a really quite a nice design that you folks did show me during the meeting we had. And I'd like Councillor Santos to hear about your design there. And that's facing Pipeline, correct?
Correct. The front entrance is more or less facing the intersection of Pipeline and Templeton.
Yeah, you've really put a lot of effort into that design and making it pedestrian friendly. Are you able to zoom into that a little bit more? Or?
I can try.
And where exactly is the rooftop patio? It is on that side?
Yeah, the rooftop patio is located here above the amenity space, above the main entrance. Are you able to see the cursor?
Yes.
Moving? Yes. Okay. So building one, it encompasses both of these pieces of this building on the site plan. And so the main entrance is located here between those two pieces of building one, and the rooftop patio is located here facing the intersection of Pipeline and Templeton.
Madam Chair, could I quickly just ask a question?
Yes.
Could you, where is the entrance? Is it off of Pipeline or is it off of Templeton to get into the complex?
For a vehicle?
Mm-hmm.
I can quickly return to our...
There's two access points, correct, Aaron?
That's correct. We have... I'll just return to the beginning and scroll through quickly to show the site plan. We did touch it very quickly there. So
yeah.
There's one entrance off of Cartesian Gate to the east here.
Okay.
And then a second onto Pipeline.
Okay.
The entrance on from Cartesian Gate is wider, correct? Look, it appears wider.
The drive aisle would be the same width, but the it does have some parallel parking on the sides and some buffer incorporated for landscaping and fence. So the space is a little bit wider, but the drive aisle would more or less be the same on both.
Okay.
And to follow up, is the idea that all these lanes would be two-way, or is it going to be, are you coming in one way and then exiting the other way? What's the flow of the vehicle traffic? Sorry, I can't see it. It's tiny.
Oh, sorry. I can zoom in a little bit more too. So each entrance will have two-way traffic.
Okay.
And then also entrances to the parkade are located convenient to each entryway. So the idea is that we would, instead of having all the traffic flowing onto Cartesian Gate to enter, which is a local road and would probably add some congestion there, we're trying to divide that up and allow people to enter off of Pipeline if their parking spaces are more convenient to that entrance, for example.
Okay.
Which building are you putting up first? Is there a plan?
I believe that is in the process of being discussed currently. There is going to be some logistical questions in that regard. I believe the ideal situation would be to have building one to be one of the first to be leased, just because that would be where the leasing office is located and the amenities. But I believe that's still being discussed in our design.
When this is all built out, which entrance do you feel one will be used more than the other? Aaron, Michael, do you know?
I think we would expect that the main entrance aligned with the corner of Pipeline and Templeton would be the primary entrance for residents and visitors to come in. Visitors arriving by car, I guess, would probably pick an entrance off the courtyard in the interior of the site, depending on where they find their visitor parking spot.
Where is your visitor parking? Is it around each building or centralized in one area only?
It's indicated by it's very kind of blurry. I apologize. This is a zoomed out image when we put it in here, but there's V's indicated here. So there would be some visitor parking spread throughout and intended to be convenient to all. So it would be, I believe, largely on the surface parking is where the visitor parking would be. But there's some conveniently located to each of the three buildings.
Great. We appreciate the collaboration that you had with my office and obviously our planner, many, many meetings. Tell us about the striped crossings and parking lot lighting that was revised as a result of those meetings.
Sure, Michael, I can address that if you'd like.
Yep, please do.
Sure.
Yep.
So after we made our initial submission for plan approval, we got some comments back from Mr. Heyer, greatly appreciated. And that was the changes we made as a result of those were to indicate more clearly that the pedestrian crossings within our site indicated here would be painted crossings as opposed to a different material, for example. So we were just clarifying and making sure that it was really clear that these are pedestrian crossing areas and that they would be highlighted with paint to be clear and safe. And then the other change we made as a result of comments was to submit some specs for exterior lighting for the parking lot. And the key takeaway from that lighting is to have lighting that would be full cutoff where necessary to avoid any spillage of light onto adjacent properties. So any light, for example, adjacent to the properties to the east, which is primarily where any parking areas would be adjacent to residential properties, those would be spec'd to be only lighting our property and not allowing light to flood onto adjacent properties.
Great. And the timeline for construction of the project, I guess this coming year, or is it 2023?
I believe construction, we're hoping to begin construction this year. And it would be, I believe, a 14 to 16 month. Michael, please correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, that's correct. The typical construction timetable for our projects would be 14 to 16 months. Yeah.
Excellent. And we have Councillor Eady here as well now. I know he's read the report, but could I just ask you to summarize once again the main points for this project, the units and the parking? And can you just restate, please, some of the main points of the project?
Absolutely, happy to. So I'll just start with the project details themselves. We are proposing 304 units across three buildings for this site. I'll just quickly reiterate the building locations. Building one is roughly L-shaped, facing Templeton Avenue to the south of the site, as well as one leg facing Pipeline Road. Building 2 is to the northwest of the site facing Pipeline Road, and building 3 is towards the interior of the site, located behind buildings 1 and 2 from the perspective of the streets. We are providing 457 parking spaces. There are 456 required, so we're just exceeding that number. And those parking spaces are being provided both in the surface parking lot as well as in the underground parkade. And there are also 95 secure bike parking spaces being provided, all in the underground parkade. And those include a bicycle repair station area, which is conveniently located next to the bike cage, which is located underneath our main amenity area with convenient access to ground floor by elevator. And I can also just touch on the landscape plan details quickly if you'd like.
Sure.
Okay. So we are exceeding the numbers of required shrubs and trees per the zoning bylaw. We're providing a 6-foot privacy fence along the north and east property lines adjacent to the residential properties. In addition to that, we are strategically locating trees along those property lines to bolster the privacy buffer there. Providing a dog run to the northwest of the site is approximately 1800 square feet surrounded by a 4-foot chain link fence. And the surface there will be pea gravel to allow for easy maintenance, durability, as well as comfort for the dogs using the dog run. And we are also providing benches and bike racks conveniently located to each building entrance to allow for convenient visitor bicycle parking.
Aaron, can you tell us about the earth bins that you're proposing for garbage? Earth bins go underground. I'm not very familiar with that kind of treatment. It's a good one though, because it would certainly keep the area cleaner, I believe. Tell us a little bit about these earth bins.
Sure, absolutely. So earth bins, I think, primarily have two main benefits compared with traditional garbage dumpster style bins. The first, as you mentioned, is that they store the garbage or recycling underground between pickups. So especially in summer, that would keep the garbage much cooler than being above ground and would help cut down on the smell, which can be a particular irritant from bins. So that's one benefit. Second benefit is just that they have a much lower profile of the portion that is above ground. So they're much more aesthetically pleasing, and they do not require the same enclosure for that reason, and therefore it's easier to maintain and keep the area clean, as you mentioned.
Excellent. Councillor Reedy, any questions at this point?
No, just actually I was reading over the report. It sounds like an excellent development.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very detailed. They've done a lot of good work here. Aaron, Michael, when we had a meeting recently, our recent meeting, we talked about green space in the area. There's a park not too far from here that's underdeveloped, and I think your group had mentioned that you might want to participate possibly in something. We can work out the details later. Is that still the case?
Yes, we're certainly open to that.
Thank you. There is a vacant park nearby, and your occupants here would certainly enjoy it, so we'll talk offline, and I really appreciate you kind of brought it up on your own. It wasn't something that I raised, and I really enjoyed the meeting we had. These are excellent plans that you've put forward, and appreciate your collaboration with our city planner. Any further questions? Okay, seeing none, thank you for your presentation today.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
No further delegations.
That's correct.
Mr. Clark?
Yep.
Councillor Reedy, would you like to take the chair back?
Sure, I can do that. Absolutely.
I will pass the chair back to you, Councillor Reedy.
Thank you for stopping in. Yeah. Anyway, it's a long story. I was late. Pardon me. Okay, so we're moving into reports. Occasional liquor permit.
The Little Brown Jug Brewing Company.
Yes, I can move this, Mr. Chair, to approve the occasional liquor permit. The event actually was held back in December, so we're just cleaning up matters here today.
We are ratifying the decision we made.
Yes, sorry. Yes, that's the correct term. Thanks.
Excellent. Thank you, Councillor Santos. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
But yeah, nobody's opposed. That's carried. Report number two, plan approval 25 DeGrave Street. That would be in your ward, Councillor Sherman?
Yes. Yeah, we'll hear from our planner.
Okay, sounds good.
Good morning, everyone. So this is.
One sec, there was no delegation in regards?
There is no delegation, which I'm surprised about.
Okay.
No one tried to register? No.
Okay.
Mr. Hare, do you know about any delegation?
I had last spoken with the applicant late last week and informed them of the date and time of the hearing and provided them with the contact information for the clerk to register as delegation if they wanted to. I'm not sure if they followed up. They did respond to my email thanking me for the information. That was about it.
Great. Okay, Mr. Rock, then you can give us a synopsis of the report. I imagine they worked with you and you're in support of this.
Yes, Councillor. So just to summarize the proposal, this is at the southeast corner of Templeton and DeGrave Street in Precinct E. You may recall that there were some previous approvals on this same property last summer, in July. The site plan for the development was approved, and then last October, the one of the four buildings was approved, the elevation design. Excuse me. So there's four buildings. Each building is six stories in height, 77 units per building. Each building requires a separate plan approval application for approval of the design and the elevations. Building A has been approved in October. This one is building B. So building A, to recap, was the first one right on the south side of Templeton. This one is the one behind building A. Overall, the look and feel of the buildings is very similar. The key difference is the colors and the materials. One of the things we asked for in the elevations was to make sure that they were using a variety of materials and colors to make the buildings each look distinguishable. So the first building was darker tones, dark stone, dark gray, hardy panels. This one is much lighter. So this one has almost like a Tindlestone type of color on the base and the columns, some red and light gray and white tones for the hardy panels, but overall the same style of roof. The entrances to the buildings for vehicles, the approaches are on DeGrave, but the access to the underground parkade is on the east building elevation, so far away from the public street. So there'll be no or minimal interaction between vehicles and pedestrians. Each unit would have a private balcony, as mentioned, 77 units in total. And we are supportive and recommending approval.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Hare.
Questions? Can I just get clarification on one thing? About the plan approval last summer, Mr. Rack, is this the one where we were going to be looking at sort of the parking lot layout and connections of paths and so on?
No, Councillor, this was the parking lot layout and path connections. That was the first approval. The first approval was for the site plan. So that includes the location of parking areas, the footprints of buildings. You may recall there was a gazebo and a landscape seating area. That was part of that first approval as well. What that allowed them to obtain was a development permit for servicing the site and getting the site development ready. The additional approvals are required for the superstructure permits to actually construct each of the buildings. And so this application is related to the construction of the second building.
All right, questions?
Yeah, just to follow up to Councillor Eby's comments, they're good ones though, because I noticed the first building hasn't even started to be constructed. So it would have been an ideal time for the applicant to come back today. Just to add, I had questions for them actually, and they haven't registered here today just yet. Kind of disappointed about that part of the process here today. Because this is for their second building, and I think they held off they just weren't quite ready to do the first one, but I haven't spoken to them recently. But I'll reach out after this meeting. And there are other subsequent buildings. How many more? Two more?
Yes, Councillor, there would be two more buildings, which have yet to be approved and will require separate plan approval applications.
Okay. All right. Well, I thank you for your summary today. And I definitely want to follow up them. When they do reach out to you, please let them know the same. And it's important to attend these types of meetings. So we're all on the public record, the applicant and the elected representatives. Mr. Chair, I will
we'll get them on next.
Move plan approval as recommended by our city planner.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Rack. Thank you, Councillor Sharma, for the motion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Councillor Santos?
Oh, sorry. Yes, I'm here. Yes, aye.
You're in favor? Okay. Nobody's opposed. That is carried. Thank you. Sorry, Councillor Santos, you're probably waving your hand. I'm not sure. Anyway, moving on to report number three. Plan approval, Cartesian Gate, DAZ, something, something, 2014. Sorry, Councillor. Well, Mr. Rack, did you want to make comments in regards to this?
Sure. I'll give a brief sort of summary or recap. We just heard from the applicant. So this property is at the northeast corner of Pipeline and Templeton, so not that far from the previous application. This one is also in Precinct E. The property is zoned multifamily large. The proposal is to construct three multifamily buildings for a total of 304 units and 457 parking spaces. The buildings would have a variety of heights, 4 to 6 stories. The height is been designed so that the taller portions of the building are more to the interior and the buildings step down to lower heights as they get closer to the adjacent lower density neighborhood. As well as then there's the landscape yards and setback areas. There are a variety of indoor and outdoor amenities being proposed here. Outdoor amenities include a fenced dog run, seating areas, ample landscaping. Indoor amenities include a fitness room, a hot tub area, sauna, games area, a theater, a business center. The garbage bins would be stored in earth bins, which are underground. We did circulate the proposed site plan to the Water and Waste Department. The Water and Waste Department has confirmed that these are serviceable by the city and they're satisfied with the volume and the general layout of the bins. So no concerns there. The applicant worked with us early on. They reached out to have conversations about access, to have conversations about process. They provided us plans late last year, and the two changes that we asked for was to clarify the method of demarcating the pedestrian crossing so that they meet, first of all, our accessibility requirements, but they're safe and convenient and direct for pedestrians. And then also the lighting. As mentioned, this site does share some lot lines with single family and semi-detached two family side-by-side homes. So we wanted to make sure that the lighting was not spilling out onto the or negatively impacting adjacent sites. So they're fully cutting off the lights so that it's pointed downwards towards the parking area, minimizing glare. Those are the two changes that we asked for. They have agreed to. We're happy with the plans and are supportive and recommend approval.
Great. Do you have any questions, anybody?
Thank you. I can go after Councillor Santos. Not sure if she has any. No. Yeah, I just wanted to, Mr. Chair, echo a lot of what our planner just said. Appreciate his collaboration with the applicant. He did reach out early on, both to himself and me. And just the accessibility, the pedestrian connectivity, the checking off all the boxes, all the things that are important to us. Being courteous to the surrounding neighborhoods. Really appreciate this attention to all that detail. And the structure itself, I mean, it's pretty amazing what they're offering here. And I'd like to welcome Ironclad to the area. It's the first project in the Old Kildonan Ward. And the amenities that they're going to be offering those that live here, being pet friendly, the large fitness center, the lounge, the rooftop patio.
Yes.
Jeez, you and I should move in. Just wonderful amenities. And I think especially through this pandemic, people are staying home more and want to enjoy where they live. So this building is going to be excellent. And the fact that the applicant also wants to participate in green space that's nearby, that's something that they raised with me. And I really do appreciate that because there is a vacant green space that does need some amenities and that'll be coming online. I'm working with another developer and in collaboration with this applicant, we can do something pretty special in the neighborhood for the residents. So just an excellent project. I'm looking forward to construction. I want to get on the site and hopefully maybe they'll have a sod turning, but following that, just seeing everything come together and finally be at its opening, because this is an excellent project. And the fact that they're exceeding the number of trees needed on the property and the parking, I mean, this is just, it's wonderful. And really, really happy that the meeting that I was able to have with them, because it just makes it even that much easier when we're sitting here today going through the final approval process.
I just had a general question before you move a motion. Mr. Rock, do you know, does this mark the completion of all the lots from the hydro line to pipeline on the north side of Templeton?
It does, Councillor, yes. This was the last vacant property. There are some two-family homes just directly to the east of this site that are under construction. But yes, after this application is processed, officially we will have processed permit applications on all the properties on the north side of Templeton and Precinct E, yes.
Right on. Excellent.
So I will move approval, Mr. Chair, and I thank David Marsh, Michael, and Aaron Snyder, and their whole team for what they put together here. It's really stellar. So I move approval of the plans as submitted.
Excellent. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Yep. Nobody's opposed. That is carried. Report number 4, Development Agreement Amendment, DASZ 30-2013, in regards to, this is a change related to a drainage culvert and such for, I think this is in the Castleberry Meadows right. area.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I see Daniel Trenchard on the screen with us there. I had an opportunity to meet with the applicant and also meet with a voice of the residents group in the area. I have an amending, a small amendment today, and I think we can move this forward. I look forward to getting the detailed plans from the applicant as to what they're going to be planting and what they plan for the area. But I think there's a sense of urgency that they'd like to move forward and get planting right in the spring, and I can appreciate that. We have Daniel, at my request, had put together an amendment. If you could read that out, Mr. Clerk.
Yes, Daniel has provided me with the wording for the amendment. And I will read it into the record. So the amendments are, under recommendation 1A, amend clause 5G by adding in quotations and the ward councillor, close quotations, after open quotations, the director of public works, close quotations. The next recommendation for amendment is, under recommendation 1A, add the following clause 5M3, namely, within the final year of the warranty period, the developer shall ensure through site visits with the ward councillor that all vegetation has been installed in accordance with plans and specifications approved by the director of water and waste, the director of public works, and the ward councillor.
And basically the first amendment, by adding the word councillor, it gives me an opportunity to see what it is, their detailed plan. Of what they're going to be putting in there starting this spring. And it gives extra assurances to the residents. They'll know that I'm involved in the process and all the way to the end of the warranty period. That would be 5 years from now.
Okay, I'll call the question on the amendment then.
Yeah, just one other thing. I just wanted to say that I really appreciated the dialogue I had with Matt Glavin on a number of occasions. He really wants to do the right thing here. And naturalizing the pond will alleviate some of the issues we've been having around the green space. So appreciate the dialogue with him.
All right. All those in favor of the amending motion on this report?
Aye.
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried. And motion to approve the development agreement.
I'm just wondering, Mr. Chair, if Daniel would like to put anything on the record? Daniel Trenchard?
No, I'm not going to.
The amendment's quite simple, Daniel, as we spoke.
Yeah, the amendment's straightforward as far as the intent. As far as the actual amendment, the applicant did mention that they may withdraw their application, but the process of that hasn't been finalized yet. So it was advised to our department last week that they may pull it. I talked to our different decision makers, so to speak, to find out the process involved in that. The easiest process was for the applicant to withdraw at committee, but the applicant couldn't make it to committee today. So as far as this recommendation, it'll proceed forward. The application, as with all applications, can be withdrawn at any time, but I think this recommendation is straightforward and it can proceed that way to the next stage.
Okay. So Daniel, that's not a conversation you had with me last week.
No.
So if there's anything else you know about that this week, you can certainly pass it on because that's the first I'm hearing. Thank you. Okay.
So you're moving.
Yes, I am moving, concurring in the report as presented with the amendments.
As amended, right. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried. Five, amendment to council conditions for rezoning 225/235 McPhillip Street, 1030 Pacific. DAS 200/2020, which is the Manitoba Building Trades Project, is it not, Councillor Santos?
That's for RAC, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
So, Councillor Santos?
Yeah, I'm here.
This is in your word. Excellent project, and it's just an amendment to deal with. I think we had a hearing on this or some kind of presentation in the past. It's just basically amending it. They don't have to provide sidewalks. According to the city's administration, which is recommended.
Our planner.
It's my report, councillors.
Okay, go ahead.
Essentially, the history is that the original council approval of this file required construction of a sidewalk on Pacific Avenue. At the time, Public Works believed that the entire building was being repurposed for the Manitoba Building Trades Institute, and they've since, through discussions with the developer and applicant, determined that they are not. The original tenant, the Winnipeg Fire Paramedic Service, has a tenancy within the building, which never changed, and the sidewalk would conflict with all of the overhead doors that they use for their maintenance facility. So between discussions with the applicant and Public Works, they determined that it wouldn't be in the best interest of anyone to have a sidewalk running along there. It would be discontinuous and only run along that property. The intent at the time was just for the students of the facility. But the students are actually on a different section of the building, is my understanding. So Public Works has agreed with the applicant that the sidewalk would not be necessary for this development. So this is just to, because the agreement hasn't been drafted, it's an amendment to council conditions as opposed to a development agreement amendment, just to delete the requirement to enter into a servicing agreement and deleting their conditions stating sidewalk, construction, traffic, all of the ancillary clauses associated with that.
Okay, so I have questions because this is new to me. So Daniel, you mentioned that there was discussions already between the proponent or the owner of the building and the city just to not develop the sidewalk along Pacific Avenue, like completely, like it's just not going to happen at all?
That's correct. Yeah.
Okay. I think there's sidewalks along McPhillips. Am I correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And then the students are accessing not through Pacific, they're actually accessing it through a different part of the building. I think that's my understanding.
That's right. Yeah.
What about fire paramedics? Was there any issues with accessing the building? Like, so when we remove sidewalks, I get kind of nervous about connection, and because I believe there is actually a bus stop right on McPhillips. So is that interrupting anything? Is like when Public Works reached out to you, was there any concerns about having no sidewalk developed at all? Like what's going to happen there in the future?
No, Public Works was agreeable to no sidewalk at all. It's actually only one block on one side of the street that would have a sidewalk. It would be discontinuous. And Public Works noted it may not be possible ever to continue it because of the alignment of the hydro poles. It's just the original construction of Pacific Avenue wasn't amenable to a sidewalk. So they could do it along this building because there's, I believe, no poles, but there is driveways. At the time of the application, Public Works' understanding was that those driveways were going to be removed, the boulevard restored, and the entire frontage along Pacific was going to be redeveloped. But they've since come to find out that the overhead doors are for the maintenance facility of the Winnipeg Fire Paramedic Service, which is being maintained within that building. So they don't want to funnel, whether it be external pedestrian traffic or whether it be the students, they don't want them to be using the sidewalk in front of the overhead doors for fear of conflicts of trucks either backing out, or they do actually in emergencies if a vehicle's in for maintenance but it's not out of service, they do sometimes in emergency cases rush out of that with lights and sirens on, so that they don't want a public sidewalk right adjacent to those overhead doors.
Okay, so those overhead doors are usable, people do use them?
Yes.
So then is that area right now gravel, cemented? Like, does it need to be redeveloped and signed, like with warning signs or anything like that to ensure there is no conflict between pedestrian, or is?
There is no sidewalk right now. So pedestrians would have to be on the street, so to speak. So right now with the street pedestrians, there's about 10 feet between the building and the street. So it's not an immediate conflict. Whereas if you have the sidewalk right at property line, you take about 8 feet away from that and you would have only maybe 2 feet, 2.5 feet between the sidewalk and the overhead door. So that you have a blind spot like that. Like it's just not amenable to pedestrian traffic.
So right now it's just for vehicle traffic.
That's right. There's no sidewalks on Pacific either side right now.
Well, I wish someone would have talked to me about this because I do have concerns. I don't know, Madam Chair, Mr. Chair, if it's appropriate. Like, what's the timeline to finish this? Could we lay it over?
You can lay it over. I misspoke just now. I said there's no sidewalk on either side. There's no sidewalk on the south side. The north side does have a sidewalk along the entire frontage of this property, but it only extends for the front. Like, so the opposite side of Pacific Avenue has a sidewalk
right
on the north side.
Okay. Yes. Okay. 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 I'm just looking at the Google Maps here. And, cause I was there for the opening and, you know, there are vehicles that do park along Pacific, but when they have to access the building, they have to go in behind through the parking lot. Mm-hmm. And there is a bus stop on McPhillips. Okay, so.
Council.
Yeah.
Councilor Santos, if you want to investigate it a bit more, the bus stop is on the south side of Pacific at McPhillips, or where there is a sidewalk, or is the bus stop on the north side of Pacific at McPhillips?
It's on the south side of Pacific. on McPhillips.
Sidewalk that is on the south side of Pacific there then, right?
Yes, so that's the one that they're saying there's no sidewalk.
I think Mr. Hare just recognized he made a slight error in that there is a sidewalk on the south side.
On the north side of Pacific.
Trenchard speaking.
Yeah. On the north side? Okay. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right.
Yeah, and if you'd like to discuss with the public service, we can lay it over for a month, and I can coordinate a meeting with Public Works and yourself, and we can make sure everybody's on the same page here.
Yeah, if that's okay. Sorry, it's just
For sure.
Yeah,
that's fine.
Okay,
I support that. Yeah.
Yeah. Off. Yeah. So you're moving to.
Just lay it over. Yeah, if we can lay it over to the February meeting so that I can have some further dialogue with the administration with respect to the sidewalk and the connection and driving and the conflict between pedestrian and vehicles.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to call the vote, but I might suggest you look into if they're realigning those bus stops on McPhillips with the new bus route system that'll be in place over the next in 2 years.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried. And that was our last report for today. Did somebody suspend the rules for other reports or?
No.
No?
I'll move adjournment, Mr. Chair.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Nobody's opposed. That is carried. All right.